We're going to be talking about two different sides of an issue. Anna's going to be talking about a new invasive insect and possibly some ways that people are looking at killing it. And I'm going to talk about the other end of the spectrum. I'm going to be talking about how not to kill insects. That may seem a little odd, but maybe I should introduce myself. My name is Paul Krosak. I'm the provincial apiarist with OMAFRA. So in a nutshell, I'm the honeybee guy for Ontario at the provincial level. I'm going to be talking today about prevention of poisoning of honeybees with pesticides. And when I talk about pesticides, I'm really talking about most specifically insecticides. Those are the ones that have most damage on honeybee colonies. Now, just to point out right from the very start, honeybees are essential for agricultural services in Ontario. They contribute somewhere from $140 to $170 million annually. Most of this is through pollination value, although you do get about $14 million in honey production as well. But really, the pollination is really the big thing, and a lot of growers really do depend on this, depending on what you're growing. At the same time, you've got insecticides that are being used, and I will be frank about it. I mean, a lot of growers do need to control their pests and their cropping systems. So you've got these pests reaching economic damaging levels, and it is important to control them. But I think you can do. There's a lot you can do to control both. You can prevent honeybee poisoning, and you can mitigate the damage to them. While still achieving good pest control. I'm not going to focus on the pest control, but really on what you can do to prevent that and some best management practices. This is just going to be the basics, what we know so far, kind of the general practices. Some are mandatory, some are voluntary, but just a lot of ones that you can do right in the field. Now let's take a look at what a honeybee colony is first. This box here. Doesn't have honeybees in it right now, but this represents what a honeybee colony would look like in the field. You may have it at the edge of a field for honey production or for nectar, pollination. But that's what you're seeing. Big box like that. These aren't live honeybees, but this kind of represents what it would look like. You've got one queen typically in a colony. She's producing anywhere from about 1,000 to 1,500 eggs a day. And her job is to provide colony cohesion and provide a large working force to take advantage of that nectar and pollen out in the environment. So a box like that would have somewhere around the order of 20,000 to 60,000 worker bees in it. Worker bees do make up the vast majority of the population. And this all depends on, you know, that 20,000 to 60,000 time of year, state of the colony, and state of the queen. The foragers, or the worker bees that leave the colony, these are the ones that may come in contact with insecticides in the field. They're going to be leaving the entrance of the colony, flying out, and depending on where the resources are and how good the resources are in the surrounding environment, they may be going anywhere from a few meters to as far as 6 miles if there's really not a lot for them to forage. Typically, though, you're looking at something like this. You see this in the field. Imagine a 2 mile radius around that, and that's where the honeybees are going to be. So where you see pesticide damage, and again, mostly insecticide damage and acute insecticide damage, you're going to see a big pile of dead bees when that happens. That's really what we want to prevent. What's happening with that is the bees are collecting an insecticide that's been applied to a crop or some other flowering plant. They bring that back and they get poisoned. You're going to see a big pile of bees right in front of the colony. That really only represents about 10% of the bees that have been damaged. The other 90% have died out there in the field. So you'll see a marked decline in the population of the honeybee colony and really bad for the health of the colony. Some may make it back into the colony and unload some contaminated pollen. If they do that, that's even worse because that starts to affect the bees inside the colony. And depending on how it's been stored, it can prolong the damage for a few months, up to a year. So that's the bad stuff. But the good news is that, you know, there are a lot of general practices that you can use to prevent honeybee poisoning. Step number one would be to not apply during when a crop is in bloom or flowering. Some labels may prevent this. So again, the label is the law, and you do have to refer to the label. If you have any questions about the label, you can talk to the MOE or PMRA and be proactive about it, but by no means do you want to use it off-label and get into an issue with them or a conflict with the beekeeper. Now, to be frank, in some instances, you know, if you can use the pesticide during a bloom, and the label allows for it, and the pest levels dictate that you have to treat, you still have some options. Time of day is also important. So the bees are foraging during daylight hours, and really the best thing you can do beyond not applying during a flowering period is applying after 8 p.m. So when you're applying at nighttime, the bees are inside the colony, they're not going to be foraging, and you're not going to be exposing them to that pesticide. Now, you do get some residual effects, so that is an issue as well, but they're not going to be exposed to the initial application, and that can go a long way in protecting them. Early morning is also good, but it's second best, and it's really a far second best to applying at night. The reason for that is that although the bees aren't active in early morning, and again, it depends on the weather and the strength of the colony, you still have that residual period. So again, the best thing you can do is to treat at night. Second best would be morning, and the absolute worst would be right in broad daylight. In addition to that, you know, just you've got a lot of options for pesticides that are available. There's a notion out there that all pesticides are as bad as others. That's simply not true. There are a lot that are actually have a minimal impact on honeybees, and we have this available on the OMAFRA website under apiculture and horticulture, and that's OMAFRA, apiculture or horticulture. They're grouped into three main classifications: group one, which is highly toxic; group two, moderately toxic; and group three, which is, it says on the poster here, moderately toxic, but should be least toxic. So you've got these three categories. You do have a lot of options there. Again, this will depend on your crop, the pest that you're trying to control, and the levels of the pest. So again, you've got a lot of options. Take a look at those. If you do happen to be in either category two or category one, you know, you've got the option of not spraying during the flowering period, but if you have to, spraying at night. In addition to the classifications, you've also got the formulations. So certain formulations are more hazardous to bees than others. Dusts are amongst the worst. Something that's a solution or a soluble powder is going to be a lot less hazardous to honeybees. So you've got also that option right there. Now, application method, we don't have that covered right now. That's something that will have an impact. Aerial is typically worse than ground spraying. And in addition to that, you know, you've also got the issue of drift. I won't go into the details of drift. You've got a lot of other stations here that can tell you, how to avoid drift, you know, for proper pest control and proper distribution of your insecticide. But drift is also a bad thing for honeybees. Where you get drift, you can get it going into areas that you didn't intend, and you can get it going onto flowering weeds, which can also be a problem for honeybees. They're attracted to those flowering weeds. They're an important source of nectar and pollen. That's one more contact point for the insecticide and the honeybee. So minimizing drift is important for that reason as well. And if depending on your weed control, you may already be controlling your weeds, and if you haven't already, just simply cutting or getting rid of those weeds is one more thing you can do. Overall, there's the mandatory, so the legislation prevents growers from applying during a fruit tree bloom. Other crops are not covered under the Bees Act, which is a provincial legislation. But then you refer to the label. So again, the label is the law, and you do have the PMRA, MOE following up on those issues. And anytime you can use avoid any conflict, you really want to go that route, especially when you do have these best practices. And again, depending on your crop, your situation with the weather and the pest levels, I mean, you're going to have to work out the details of that too. But as far as best practices, this is kind of the general and the basics right now. One important tool that beekeepers and growers and applicators all should be using is communication. That's something that really doesn't get used enough. But your landowner is kind of your contact point. They can tell you who's spraying and when, and if they don't know, they can put you in contact with who does know. In addition to that, if you have any questions, contact myself at the apiculture program, OMAFRA apiculture, and I can answer any questions that way. That's really the basics of prevention. And again, I think there is more we could do with getting more detailed information on application and working more closely with grower groups as well.